And it's time now for the Power Play Podcast presented by National Coney Island. I'm Jonathan Kidd along with Sean Belegian. Sean, how are you today?
Pleasure to be here, buddy, and thanks to our friends at National Coney Island for being a part of it. And, you know, anybody that listens to this, anybody that watches this for what it's worth, please support those who support this great game and go out and have a lunch at National Coney Island, huh?
Tell us about your days at DFN with National Coney Island.
Yeah, it was funny. We used to have something called the Coney Bet, where instead of making bets for dollars, we would make bets using Coney as our monetary value. So, for example, I'll give you a perfect example. Our good friend Ryan Ermani from Fox 2. Ryan Ermani is a big Michigan football fan.
Oh, of course, along with me.
Yes, and I'm a big Michigan State fan, and I used to make him Coney bets for Michigan State games. So, I won a few Coney's in the span of time there, but hey, there's nothing like a Coney. I mean, it's a Michigan thing. Obviously, it's a Detroit thing, and in my opinion, it's a perfect fit for doing something like this. So we thank them for coming aboard, man.
You can watch our podcast at statechampsnetwork.com, youtube.com/statechampsTV, and the audio podcast, you can listen to it on SoundCloud. Your latest rankings have just came out.
Yeah.
You can see it at statechampsnetwork.com. We're going to talk about a few teams today that I feel they're on the rise.
Yeah.
You feel that they're on the rise, mm-hmm. too. Let's talk about Hancock. They're seventh in the state. You know, what do you feel about these Hancock up in UP?
Well, you know, number one, there's a tremendous amount of competition up north in the UP. I don't think, frankly, that maybe people perhaps understand the level of competition up there. And what Hancock has done, and you can go look at their record, they've really taken the anybody, anywhere kind of approach. They'll play anybody. And that's Hancock is way up there in the state of Michigan. You know, you put the mitten out and go to the upper left and everything. So a lot of respect for what Hancock is doing, and they just keep getting the job done. I think they're right there with Flint Powers, 6-1, half a dozen of the other. And, you know, in recent years, you've seen Houghton. You know, it's been Houghton. Then it was Hancock. Then it was Calumet. And I think this year, there's quite the battle up there. I'm not counting out Coach Markham and Houghton just yet. And you know Calumet, I mean, the Copper Kings get hot. But I think right now, the bragging rights in the very, very tough UP go to Hancock. They just grind you out. That's the way that they won a title a couple years ago. And I think that's working for them again now.
And you feel like when it comes to the playoffs, it's going to be between them and Houghton.
Yeah, I like those both those teams, because I think in years gone by, John, if you remember 10, 15 years ago, a lot of times those teams in the UP would get here and maybe they didn't have the depth. And so you would see they would go up against a team that was deeper and everything, and they would be gassed, I guess would be the best word to say it. Their benches are deeper. They go deeper now, and that's why you've seen teams from the UP have the amount of success that they have had. As I mentioned, Hancock won just a couple years ago, so I really like those two teams up there. Travis Perry, you know, at Flint Powers, he's been one of those guys. He's been the bridesmaid for a while. He's eventually going to break the seal. I wouldn't be surprised if it was.
And we talked about that in the last couple podcasts. Like, is this going to be their time?
Yeah, and you know what? It's going to be interesting. But you know, one of the cool things to me is we always talk about the usual suspects. You have other teams that have kind of popped up in that region. You know, Saginaw Heritage, they made it to the Division II semifinals in 2013, but they've been outstanding under J.J. Bamberger. Davison is a team. I know we're going to touch on them later, but Davison is legitimate. Yeah. So, I mean, that's what's really cool is you're seeing some teams really start to get their act together. And in the process, I think it improves at least the perception of some of the teams in their region.
Let's talk about Saline. They're number 8 in the state. You had a few coaches off the record say, why you have Saline 8? Last year, you know, we thought they were going to lose to Livonia Churchill in the quarterfinals. Oh, we thought, oh, Churchill's going to be in there in the semifinals. But Saline pulled it off. They made it to the semis. And they gave Forest Hills Northern Eastern a great game. what is about them that they can take the next step?
I think first and foremost, and when you talk to coaches, this is a guy who's very respected amongst coaches. I think it's Coach Paul Fassbender. You know, he's had success at a couple different places, and he's made that translate to Saline. And again, I challenge people, take a look at one schedule. I think a schedule tells you a lot about a team. And sometimes, and we'll get on this later, sometimes maybe a team's right around 500. But if you dig a little deeper and you look at who they're playing, you're like, this team can play anybody. Saline is a team that has been playing good teams, and they've been winning against good teams. I think they're a team that flies completely under the radar in terms of maybe what the fans are thinking. But I think the coaches, especially the coaches that might have to play them, I think the coaches feel differently. Because, you know, I know some Division II coaches that are kind of looking at that region and going, my goodness gracious, you got Plymouth and Livonia Stevenson on one side. You got Trenton and Saline on the other side. What a complete debacle that could be for somebody.
And that's going to be a pre-regional, Trenton and Saline.
Yep, and it's going to be, hey, and listen, Trenton's legitimate. I mean, not that Trenton went anywhere, but I think Chad Clements, this is the best Trenton team, I think, since their last championship in 14. And I'm really happy for Chad. He's a good guy. But listen, those guys know. Can Saline knock those teams off? Absolutely. Yeah. I Jerry Vento, he's another one. I think this might be his best team at Plymouth. Yeah. Don't overlook Plymouth. You know, if you knock off Livonia Stevenson in that game, all of a sudden you've got some momentum and you got some confidence in yourself. But I think Saline fits right in there. I really do, John. And I think perhaps it's the guys that aren't in Division II and aren't paying close attention to Saline that maybe don't know how good Saline is.
You're watching and listening to the Power Play podcast presented by National Colony Island. We're going to continue with our rankings. Saginaw Heritage, you have at number 19. They made the jump from Division 3 all the way up to Division 1. What was the reasons behind that?
Well, I think, you know, it's interesting when you look at Saginaw Heritage in recent years. As I mentioned, they made it to the Division II semifinal in 2013.
Yeah, they lost to Stevenson.
Yeah, they lost to Stevenson that game. So they've had, you know, a pretty good amount of success in all divisions. In my opinion, when I look at it, I think their region is one with the Division I teams where I think Saginaw Heritage could take a long run. As a matter of fact, just looking ahead, I think they're going to be one of the teams that end up in the Final Four based on, you know, what they
it's
have.
Kind of like when Bay City All Saints or the Bay City team made it all the way there a few years ago.
And with that being said, they're completely legitimate. I mean, they are. Again, I challenge people, go look at a team's record. Go look at who they are playing and who they are beating. And a lot of times, John, to me, a loss tells you something. Sometimes if you have that tough loss or you tie a team, I think you learn a lot about a team in that regard too. So Saginaw Heritage is a team, in my opinion, I think in Division I, they might have, I don't want to say an easier road and mean that to be disrespectful, but I think it's an easier road than perhaps the one they would have in Division III.
And in that area, you got Davison at 23, and they beat Saginaw Heritage.
Yeah, Davison's a great story. I love these stories, John. I really do, because
they were in the finals in the early 2000s.
Yeah, exactly. I love these stories because, you know, again, you have the usual suspects, and then you have a team like Davison that maybe flies under the radar a little bit, and perhaps people don't notice until they win a game like that, until they win a game 6-3. So I think they're going to be a team to watch, no doubt about it. And to me, John, that is what's fun about it. And a lot of times somebody says, well, maybe you're overlooking this team or maybe you're overlooking that team. There are a lot of teams that are close to breaking the seal. Like, I was talking to Coach Nick Field at Lake Orion. Lake Orion's a darn good team. They're a team that's very close. You and I, Birmingham, you know, there's another team that, you know, they're unbeaten right now, and I'm going to be really intrigued to see what happens when they play DCD. I think that'll tell you a lot, because Detroit Country Day is a team that, John, I think you had no choice but to put Detroit Country Day in the rankings, and deservedly so.
With Birmingham Unified, is it just right now, it's just the schedule?
Yeah, absolutely. And I don't, you know, I'm not...
We're not disrespecting the schedule. You're undefeated. It's a good start.
It is what it is, to use a term that maybe some people have heard of. But it's, you know, John, to me, beating RU, beating Rochester United is a it's a good win. That gets you on the paper. But I think to make a bigger splash, they have a big weekend coming up. As I mentioned, a game against DCD and arguably one of the best goalies in the state, in Junior Sam Avola. So this is going to be a scenario where I promise you, and if somebody from Birmingham's listening right now, I promise you, you beat Detroit Country Day, you keep winning, you're going to be in the rankings. You've earned that right.
And also in the OAA, we have Troy at 24.
Yeah, Troy is another team.
They're the United squad.
Yeah, they're very intriguing to me because you have Ike out there, and I think everybody knows the work that Bob Hall does, but you have Troy, and I think because Troy's done it for a couple years now people are starting to take notice and say, okay, well, what's going on there? What's the scenario there? So that's what I'm intrigued about, to see how much it can continue, because how do you become a usual suspect? You keep getting on the map. And I think Troy has been a team that in the last couple of years has been able to put themselves on the map. Take a look at, I'll go to the west side, Joel Brazil and Granville. I mean, how many people knew what was going on with Granville? Well, when you do it year after year after year, you become a usual suspect.
A couple weeks ago when we had Coach David Mitchell from Livonia Stevenson, we talked about the MIHL showcase and the experiences there. That's going to be in a couple weeks, but I want to touch on the Michigan Public High School Hockey Showcase that is going on in Chelsea in a couple weeks as well. It's after the MIHL showcase. It's in its sixth year. Good games there too.
I enjoy it. I'm going to try to get out there. I was able to get out there the last couple of years, and I want to give a special shout out to the head coach of Chelsea, because I think the coaches know this. John, you probably know this. A guy like Don Wright does so much behind the scenes. I don't think the average person understands that. And you know, that's something that, you know, he hosts it and he puts on a great show. He puts on a great show for the teams and he puts on a great show for the media. So I want to give a shout out to certainly Coach Wright and the Chelsea Bulldogs in particular for really getting behind that. But no, I love the idea. I think originally people kind of...
Well, at that time, I remember it was, you know, some schools that played in the MIHL showcase were not happy with it. Let's start our own. And then the problems early on, it was competing at the same weekend.
Yeah.
With the, you know, now they're waiting until after the MIHL showcase. So you have those teams that were playing in the MIHL showcase would be able to play in this public high school showcase.
And you know what I think has changed? And you can tell me if you agree or disagree. You know what I have found? I have found that coaches are acting like adults now, and everybody's rowing in the same direction. And when you hear people say the more the merrier, yeah, let's have a tournament up in Traverse City. Let's have a tournament up in Gaylord. Let's go up and make that trek to the UP and play for the Miners Cup. You know, let's do an MIHL
KLAA
showcase. I love that. The more the merrier, because it showcases this fantastic game. I challenge some of the teams out there, you know, to get behind that and do that. I think it'd be fun. You know what would be great is to take some teams from the west side of the state, and there's a slew of good teams out there. You know, Forest Hills Central. I want to give a shout out to Forest Hills NE because, you know, they're a team that's been able to make some run. Mike Slobodnik and Grand Rapids Catholic Central. Of course, we mentioned Coach Brazil. I think it would be great to get a bunch of those teams together on the west side and have some kind of tournament. Or even say to some, a bunch of teams in the mid-region of the state, you know, to say to Cadillac, to say to Big Rapids, let's do something like this. Let's put a showcase on for our players. So the more the merrier. I think it's a great thing, and I totally support any kind of tournament like that. And John, as a matter of fact, if you want to carpool out to the public school showcase, I'll drive. How's that?
Yeah, and I noticed that it's only going to be a 3-day tournament. Before it was like a week long, and then it was like, I think some schools had a drive, have a game on Monday, and then they have a game on Saturday. Yep. I think it's more convenient that it's just a 3-day.
Absolutely, I agree. Get in, get out, get the product out there.
And I looked on there today, and some notable matchups. We have Northville against Utica Eisenhower, Plymouth versus Davidson, Saline and Salem's going to play, Allen Park and Birmingham Unified, and the host school, Chelsea, plays Marquette.
You know, it's interesting you mentioned Northville because I live in Northville. I'm able to see Northville quite a bit, and Coach Robert, I love the guy. I think he's been great for the game. But the game that jumped out to me last year was Forest Hills Central in Northville, because I mean, you had a top team in Division I taking on a top team in Division III, and I thought it was a fantastic game. And I remember talking to you shortly thereafter, and I said, this Northville team is capable of making a run. They could go to the semifinals at USA Hockey Arena, and you agreed with me, and they made it come true. And you know, Coach Zaschek came so close. It's a buzzsaw out there on the west side, in that side of the bracket. But you saw some outstanding games out there, no doubt about it. And I think the word showcase is what comes to mind, because sometimes you get an opportunity to see a team that maybe you've heard about, but you haven't had a chance to see them. I'll go back a few years ago, Romeo. And I remember I saw Romeo.
They beat Plymouth that game.
I remember I saw Romeo play, and I called you, and I called a couple other people, and I said, this team's legitimate. They are absolutely legitimate.
And was this the same year they won the state title, or the year before?
It was the year before, when everybody's going, Romeo. Yeah. And, you know, they had a good year that year. A year later, they won the championship. But I told anybody that would listen, there are two guys on that team that could play with anybody in the state. And, you know, I'm not trying to toot my horn when I say that. I'm trying to emphasize, if there's a team out there that you haven't had a chance to go see yet, oftentimes you get an opportunity at one of these showcases, and you can see for yourself why people are talking up this team, or why their record is what it is.
Or even Escanaba a few years ago.
Absolutely.
That was my first chance to see Levi Wonder. Yep. And a lot of these coaches and players was watching him, and everyone's like, who's this Levi Wonder kid? They got a good look and saw him.
Boy, did they ever. He was something special, and he was one of those guys that, again, John, I think anybody who played against him, anybody who coached against him, you know, even in some of the things that happened in the off season, they would tell you right away, okay, you've got to see this kid. Well, it doesn't really translate to people like you, to people like me, to really to anybody, until you see it with your own two eyes. And when you had an opportunity to see him, you saw just how good he was.
This is the Power Play Podcast presented by National Coney Island. And we're going to be talking about the top five games of the week. We had a fun one last week. We had some good ones, and it came out all good.
Yeah, you know, I got a chance to go on Saturday and see a good portion of Catholic Central and Cranbrook. And that Cranbrook team is dangerous, because really, nobody had been hanging with Catholic Central, and Cranbrook gave them a good go. CC pulled away at the end, but John, I need to say again for the record, I think CC is head and shoulders better than anybody right now in the state.
And we're going to be talking about CC right now. They're going to be playing Birmingham Brother Rice on Wednesday at the Oak Park Ice Arena at 7:30. CC did beat Brother Rice 4-1 in November. But Brother Rice is on a little bit of a roll right now.
One thing that you cannot counter for is passion and emotion. And I think that Kenny's done such a fantastic job with Brother Rice, because they started out the season, they stumbled a couple times, and they have been on fire. And that is going to be a difficult team for anybody to beat. They've got a 5-game winning streak, but again, I challenge people to go look and see who they beat. You know what I mean? I think everybody knows the rivalry between Brother Rice and Catholic Central.
In any sport.
Yeah, exactly. So again, on paper, I don't mean disrespect to Brother Rice. I think Catholic Central is the best team, period, in the state. So you can say that on paper, but the game is played on the ice, and what you can't put into that equation is the passion and emotion and everything like that. That's going to be a great game.
So you think it's going to be CC?
I think it's going to be CC. You're going to have to get a Herculean effort to beat Catholic Central. Listen, I don't want to say something like this because I don't want to put undue pressure on Catholic Central, or certainly a great guy like Coach Cal. They're arguably one of the best high school teams I've seen in a while. In my opinion, they're that deep.
Up of those teams in 09 and 10?
They're that deep. Yes, they're that deep. They're deep. They're incredibly coached well. I mean, you got an NHLer on the bench. You got, you know, I think Coach Cal, I think his reputation precedes itself. So I really think Catholic Central is that good this year.
And I'll be out there taping the game. It's going to be our main event on State Champs on Sunday. Oh. Not 9 a.m. on Fox Sports Detroit. You know, I have to get that plug in there.
Way to go.
Yes, exactly. We're going to go up north a little bit. We got Alpena again at Gaylord on Friday at the Gaylord Sportsplex. Alpena is 10-4-1. Gaylord's 10-3-1. This is the first meeting of the year between these two, and then they'll meet later on at near the end of the regular season.
Well, and this is what I'm talking about, because I would love to say that I've had an opportunity to go up to beautiful Alpena or beautiful Gaylord. I haven't seen either one of these teams play. I would love an opportunity to see these two teams play. You know, I would love it, whether it be up at the Gaylord Sportsplex or at the public school or at the MIHL Showcase. This is intriguing because I think these are two teams. I think people forget what a power Alpena was back in the day. And Gaylord, obviously, we brought it up earlier. You have some tournaments up in the Sportsplex. That's a very intriguing game to me because I guess studying both of their schedules, I want more. You know what I mean? Okay, what is this team about? And I think they're both going to have an opportunity to present their case.
When we pick these top games of the week, we want to make sure like this is all around the statewide. You know, we can easily just pick all the top five games in Southeast Michigan and just call it a day, but we want to make sure the whole state is represented.
No, I think that's very important because I wouldn't be so short-sighted about it because, you know, you see teams from all over the state win championships and make great runs. You know, Granville has become a mainstay at Division One. Hey, listen, Forest Hills NE has been able to do a lot of damage in Division Two as well. So going to a semifinal and then losing in the final last year. So it is going to be a fun time to see, you know, who pops their head up this year.
Let's go to Friday now. Allen Park plays number 17, Detroit Country Day. You have them 17th in your top 25. They're not even in the coaches' rankings. They have a great goaltender.
Yeah, they do. Sam Avola's outstanding. It's interesting. Talking to a few coaches after our rankings came out, and I'm not making this up, a few coaches said, yeah, we got to get them in. Because, you know, it's been a slow build for them. You know, Sam Avola, if you don't know his stats, he's got a goals against average under one.
Under .90.
He's got a save percentage, I think 954, if I'm not mistaken. So this is a guy that is putting up great numbers. And you know what? The team around him, they put together some nice wins now. And Allen Park is a team. You and I have talked about this before. The Jags have shown they can play with anybody.
They tied Trenton this year, 3-3.
Exactly. You've seen that historically for years. You know, when Coach Quint had some good teams at Roosevelt, they could play with them. So this is a Jag program that, you know, they're 6-4-2. Are they capable of stopping, you know, this hot Country Day team? Yeah, that's an intriguing matchup. I'm glad you picked that.
Do you feel like this is like Farmington all over again a few years ago, where you can take a goalie and ride them all the way
this
day?
That's a really good point.
Depending on the region and how far the world they
absolutely
have to go.
You know, I think the Yellow Jackets have been close in recent years. I think they've been very close. But when... Here's the deal at this level. I think, John, you know this, and I think any of the coaches out there would agree with it. If you have that goalie, you can win two or three games with that guy by himself. I mean, I always joke with Coach Ronan at Cranbrook, who's a great ambassador for the game. The Lethemann game has grown in myth and legend to mythical proportions in the last 5 years. You know, he made 10,000 saves, you know, things like that. So I think that Sam Avola is that type of guy that could take them on a long, long run.
And Country Day did beat Allen Park earlier in the year, 2-1. So we'll see how the second matchup goes. Continue on Friday. We got Plymouth at Heartland. You have Plymouth 11th. You have Heartland 6th. You know, you stated earlier, Plymouth is a dangerous team.
I think this is, Coach Vento has done a fantastic job there. I think this may be, and I'm not speaking for him because I have not spoken to him about it. I think this may be his best team. And
He had good teams.
He's had good teams. I mean,
made the quarterfinals in Division One and lost to CC, but I feel like the winner, you know, like we talked earlier, like, when they play Stevenson, that could be the game that they can go far.
Yeah, it's that would be a great statement maker. But I think this has been his best team so far. I think everybody knows about what Coach Gadwa has done. He's a little bit like Travis Perry to me in the regard that he has done such a fantastic job for so many years. Eventually, that seal's going to be broken. And I'm not talking about just getting back to, in this case, the Division II semifinals or the finals, but winning it all. So this is a matchup of two teams that in my opinion, John, either one of these teams could knock off anybody in Division II. anybody. So when you get a game like that, that's beautiful.
And what do you see in this matchup?
You know what? I think Plymouth is deeper than people give them credit for.
I saw Plymouth play Heartland last year.
I like Heartland at Heartland, don't get me wrong. But I think that Plymouth is deeper than they get credit for. I think they've got a really good blue line as well. That's a flip the coin game, even in Heartland. I mean, if you're asking me to choose, I kind of like Heartland at home. I think if the game was in Plymouth at the Icebox, I think I'd take Plymouth.
I feel like this is the top game of the week. I know we don't really, you know, number these 1 through 5. I feel like this is going to be the best game of the week. It's Trenton at Livonia Stevenson. I feel like in the last 4 to 5 years, this is like now the new hockey rivalry.
Phenomenal. It's incredible. And it's
because they always meet in the playoffs.
Well, and you know what's interesting about it? I think there's a lot of respect in the rivalry, too. Yeah. You know, it really seems to me there's a lot of respect.
When Mike Turner was there.
Yeah, Coach Turner's great. And I'm so happy for Chad Clemens because I think, how do you replace a guy like Mike Turner?
Yep.
You can't do that. So Chad has done it the right way, and he's built this thing up, and I think that team is, you know, I'm going to say the same thing about this game that I said the last game. Trenton or Livonia Stevenson could beat anybody in Division II. And that's what's interesting about this is when you have games like that, you'd say the same thing about Heartland, Plymouth, Trenton, Livonia Stevenson. I mean, they're teams that could beat anybody in Division II. Trenton, of course, led by Drew Welsh. What an unbelievable story this kid has turned into.
And Trenton's 11-2-1 in the highly competitive MIHL.
Isn't that crazy? And, you know, the thing that you have to remember, John, is they're 11-2-1, but they're 9-0-1 in their last 10 games. Yeah. When you're playing that type of schedule, you're doing something right.
And Livonia Stevenson, they play teams in the MIHL as well this year, so it's going to be a battle of wills in this game.
Yeah, Stevenson has some nice wins. You know, they're another team. The KLAA, I think we know that. But Mitchell will play anybody, anywhere. You know, they knocked off Brother Rice. They have CC coming up. You know, they lost to Orchard Lake St. Mary's, who's, you know, number two in our list, to be sure. But this is a team in Livonia Stevenson that it may be Mitchell's deepest team, and that's a big statement, but I think it may be his deepest team. And when you have a guy like Will Trage in between your pipes, you can knock off anybody. But I think Mitch, they come in waves. Bonet, number four on defense, is he's a do-it-all defender. He's a fun one to watch for me, John, because when he was a sophomore, he was a good player, and you saw signs. Now as a senior, he's matured into an exceptional.
And I'm going to put you on the spot. I know you're good friends with Mitch. Who wins this game, Trenton and Stevenson?
I'm going to be a coward, just like the Heartland game. If it was down in Trenton, I'd take Trenton. It's in Stevenson. I'm gonna take Stevenson.
Yeah, I know. In the last couple of years, like, it's been the road team that wins.
Yeah, isn't that amazing? Yeah, it's incredible. Well, you know, they're in all likelihood. Plymouth might have something to say about it, and Saline might have something to say about it. But in all likelihood, I think both teams are looking ahead. But coaches don't look ahead. We're allowed to look ahead. The way Trenton's playing right now, though, man. Again, I need to say it. They beat Port Huron Northern.
We are bringing back the high school hockey player of the year.
Yes,
and it's presented by National Coney Island, who's also the sponsor of this podcast.
Go get lunch at National Coney, all right?
Exactly. So we have the top 10 list. And Sean, how did we came about this?
Well, it's interesting. At the beginning of the year, as you know, we talk to a lot of different coaches, and we get their take on players. And I always tell people, you can nominate your guy. If there's a guy that you really like, most coaches will you know, say, I really like this guy. And if, you know, there isn't a guy that they don't like, they won't nominate him. So
exactly.
I think they're very fair to the process. So what we do is we talk to a lot of different coaches, and I've tried to vary who I talk to the last few years. And then you and I sit down and we talk about it. And then it's an evolving process because we came out with our first list, December 2nd? And since then, I have talked to another group of coaches. I'm not going to mention their name, but I've gotten some input from other coaches. And one guy that we added was Drew Welsh, because I had a couple people say that kid has to be on the list. And he has absolutely earned his way on the list, I might add. But it is an evolving process. And John, the one thing that I like that we keep true to the process, and we keep true to talking to the coaches, and a mitigating factor in this, right or wrong, is how far does your team go in the playoffs? And that's one thing that it could be the mitigating factor when we decide on this one all said and done.
And we're going to have the fans involved, too.
Absolutely. Love it.
And the winner of the online vote, you're going to be voting at statechampsnetwork.com. The winner of the online vote will have an automatic berth into our Final Four. We'll be announcing our Final Four near the end of the hockey season. Yep. And then after the season concludes, we will pick our winner. So here we go. Our first guy on our list is Drew Welsh from Trenton.
20 goals, 14 assists, and you know, I'm going to keep talking about this. Five goals against Port Huron Northern. That's an MIHL game. A 6-3 victory, and he pots five. He has been on fire. He put on a show at the MIHL KLAA Showcase. He has been absolutely on fire. Well-deserved on that list.
A few years ago, we had a Hockey Player of the Year in Andrew Sawyer,
yep,
from Trenton,
yep,
as well. What can you see out of him?
Welsh has been an absolute monster. There's no other way to say it. I wish that I could break it down for you. When you're scoring at the pace that he's scoring at, that's a special type of player. And, John, I keep saying this. Forget about what I say. Forget about what you say. When multiple coaches tell you a month into the season that there's something special about this kid, you have to get him on the list, tells you all you need to know. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, so I'll defer to a bunch of coaches that have to play against this guy and let Drew Welsh and his play speak for itself.
Exactly. Next on our list from the KLAA from Brighton High School, Adam Conquest.
Well, he's a guy that he missed a couple games early. I think everybody will remember what he did last year. He was a one-man wrecking crew in the Division I final against Catholic Central. He really was phenomenal. He is a BGSU commit. This is a guy that's going on. But I think recently he's upped his game as well. This is still a darn good Brighton team. Let's not forget that. You know, I think sometimes.
And what does this say? I hate to interrupt you. Is that what does it say that he's a high school hockey player committing to a college?
I think it's awesome. You know, we're seeing it more and more. You know, some guys have moved on to play in the USHL and then they get their commit after that. But John, to me, it's awesome that we're seeing this. And it's a subtle reminder to the young players out there, to the kids out there. You can and will be noticed if you decide to stick at this level. So it's pretty cool.
Exactly. And then we're going to stay in the KLAA. When we talked about Heartland earlier, Josh Albring's on our list.
Well, he's another guy that if it seems like he's been there forever, he has been. And
yeah, it feels like he's been there for 7 years.
Yeah, that's exactly it. You know, he's a big, strong player. He was a member of the Dream Team last year, as recognized by the coaches. And, you know, this is you know, his year. There's no doubt about that. And, you know, this could be Heartland's year. You know, I mean, you could say that in any given year about what Coach Gadwa has been able to do. But I think when you have a special talent like Josh Albring, it really is something special.
And what does it say to, I thought, he was a junior last year, he's going to leave.
Yeah.
And he's back.
Absolutely. Well, and that's, to me, that's the coolest thing about this list is you see guys that have been where they've been at for a long time now. And that's really cool to me that guys are staying and guys are getting noticed. And again, you send the message to the kids out there, you're going to get noticed. Don't believe me, that the assistant general manager of the Carolina Hurricanes said that, and Mike Vellucci. Yeah.
Exactly. And on the west side of state, we have Shane Haggerty from Granville.
Well, you know, Granville in recent years has had pretty good talent all across the board. I think on the blue line, and this year is no different. I think there are a couple blue liners that could certainly be recognized for Granville, but we're going to go with Haggerty. The thing about him, John, is he's not the sniper, so to speak. He's not the guy, maybe like Welsh, who's going to go out there and score you a bunch of goals. He gets other players involved. Playmaking is something big for him, and he's led the way for Granville.
And we talked earlier about Hancock. We're going to go back up north. Alex Nordstrom.
He's another one. He has been at Hancock, I'm convinced, for 15 years.
Yeah, same thing with Josh Albring.
And he's only a junior. Yeah. I mean, that's the crazy thing about Nordstrom. And, you know, Nordstrom has scored some big goals in his career already to this point. If you remember, he scored, correct me if I'm wrong, the overtime winner against Cranbrook in the semis a couple years ago. And then they end up winning the title. But he's having another monster year. And I'll tell you what, I think Coach Dan Rollo has done a fantastic job up there with Hancock.
And just a note, that This is not a senior award. It could be anybody.
No,
it could be a freshman. It could be a sophomore. It could be a junior.
Yep.
You know, when Dominic Lux won our award a few years back, he was a junior.
He was a junior.
We're just going to let you guys know this is not just a senior award. This is for anybody.
Yep.
Continuing on our list from Detroit Catholic Central, our number one team in the state, Brendan West.
Well, I'm gonna quote Coach Cal about this. I had a chance to talk to Brandon Kalinicki after the CC game, and I asked him about Brendan West because we knew that we were gonna have him on this list, and this is what Cal said. What I love is the things that he does and doesn't get enough credit for. He's strong on the stick. He wins the 50-50 puck battles all over the ice. And I'll tell you what, watching him play, he does have that 200-foot game. And he's another example of lead by example, because I think you watch one of your captains, a guy who has so much talent, go out there and work the way that he does. And John, that stuff's contagious. You want to go match that level of intensity.
And I noticed in past CC teams, you didn't have like a leading score. It was always in bunches.
Yep.
Do you feel like Wes is that guy that I'll put you guys on my back?
I think so. I think he's a guy that when that opportunity presents itself, that he can do that. But, you know, he, again, is another one of those guys that maybe if you're looking for the bombastic numbers, they might not be there. But if you're looking for a guy that other coaches are drooling over, he might be the guy that they're looking at.
And we're going to go to Flint Powers here in, you know, Division III Power, the number one team in Division III, according to the Coaches Association. Sam Lykel.
Well, here's the thing. I mean, the numbers speak for themselves. He's got 27 points in just 14 games. But I'm going to repeat a line that I used earlier. Sometimes losses tell you a lot about a team. They lost 3-2. Orchard Lake St. Mary's came from behind and
knocked off. And that's part of our criteria is the competition level.
Absolutely.
So here we go.
They lost 3-2. Orchard Lake St. Mary's came from behind and knocked them off 3-2. I think, number one, that shows well for Flint Powers Catholic. Not that Travis Perry and the Chargers need that, but I think it shows nice for them, and I think it shows nice for Sam as well, because he scored both their goals. When you're scoring two goals against the number two team in the state, and I think Orchard Lake St. Mary's, to me, it made a very, very strong case for being the number two team in the state. That speaks volumes for me. So you have the productivity, and you have the productivity against a caliber of opponent like Orchard Lake St. Mary's, a well-deserved spot.
And we know we have a lot of forwards on this list, but we do have a couple defensemen. The first one is Jack Sargent from Northville, and it's another one that we feel like he's been there for 8 years.
He has been not only a tremendous player to watch, but he's one of those guys when you talk to him off the ice, he's just got a great personality. He's a smiling guy, and I talked to Coach Robert about him, and you know what he said is Jack is a leader on and off the ice. He is a guy that loved high school hockey, and I'll add to that. Jack is another one of those players that had an opportunity to go elsewhere, and he stayed at Northville, and he helped the Mustangs. He was a big part of the reason why the Mustangs went to the semifinals last year, and he's a big part of the success they're having this year.
And he's a scoring defenseman, too. He has over 10 goals.
Absolutely. He does so much. You know, Jack is one of those players. He does so much. He has been fun to watch. He was, you know, he stood out, I think, early on because of his skating, but now he does so much, he really, really stands out.
And another one on those lists, we had a little debate about this, you know, when we were deciding our top 10 and another defenseman, we decided on Jordan Kovacs from Warren DSL.
Yeah, senior blue liner. He really is leading the way for De La Salle. Now, you know, I'll say this again and use De La Salle as an example. We were talking about Cranbrook earlier. Pay no attention to the record of the Pilots. The Pilots are a team that can knock anybody off.
Yep, and, you know, again, the MIHL schedule, you know, and then once you get down to Division III, it's fair game.
Yep, no doubt about it.
And lastly, we the only goalie on this list, Will Trege, Livonia Stevenson.
Well, I think if you talk to coaches, they would probably say almost unanimously that Will is the best goaltender in the state. Will is a great story because Will probably could have and should have played if he was in another place when he was an underclassman. But I use the term, he was an understudy to Cullen Barber. And you know what? You never heard Will complain. He was like, how can I get better? What can I do to get better? And I think it's shown itself. And Coach Mitchell said, Will is a tireless worker who has been the backbone of our program the past couple of years. He also possesses next-level abilities. I think Coach Mitchell would know something about that. You know, he's been able to graduate a few players to that next level, playing Division I and whatnot. And Coach Mitchell was able to play Division I himself for Western Michigan back in the 90s. So Will Tragge is another in a long line of a pretty good Stevenson goaltenders, and I think before all is said and done, he might be considered up there with any of them.
So that's our top 10. You can go to statechampsnetwork.com and cast your vote today. Like we said earlier, the winner of the online vote automatically gets a berth into the Final Four. I know you just talked about Tragge quick maybe being up there. Who do you think is the early favorites right now?
Well, you know what? I think you have to start with Drew Welsh, and we listed these. We didn't put them in the order of importance. It was just random order. But I think you have to start with Drew Welsh. I mean, really, I mean, what he's doing from a scoring standpoint, and John, you touched on it. It's who they're playing, too. When you're doing this against MIHL opponents, when you're doing this against KLAA, I've got a soft spot in my heart for Brendan West. I really do, because West, while it may not show with the bombastic numbers, I challenge anybody, watch him play, and you'll see why coaches are so high on him. I wouldn't count on Alex Nordstrom either. You know, that Hancock team is very capable of winning it all. And if Alex Nordstrom leads the way, he's going to be hard to pick against.
And just to let you guys know, listening or watching this, this is not a top 10 and this is it. We can be adding players, deleting players.
Yep.
We want to hear from you. So if you want, you know, if you feel you disagree with our top 10, we want to hear from you. So that's it for the Power Play podcast here on the State Champs Podcast Network, presented by National Coney Island. We're going to be back here again next week.